Hearthstone Thailand Major. My name is TJ. I'm joined for the next game by Patra. And it should be a good one. You guys cast the last match, which had a pretty exciting Yogg-Saron on.
I know. And this time I get to cast with you again. I haven't seen you since Singapore.
Yeah, it's been a while. Looking forward to it.
Is it your first time here in Thailand?
It is, yeah. It is. I've been a lot of other places in Southeast Asia.
Yeah.
I've been casting all the majors and stuff.
Yes, you've been all over the place, TJ.
Yeah. So
marking your territory everywhere.
Yeah. So this next match we have coming up is between a player that's been in the scene for a long time, all the way back to like 2014. His name's Eason. He's a player from Taiwan. He's been in and out of teams, like popular teams in Taiwan. He's now on J Team, and he's going to be playing up against Johnson, who's a player from Singapore. You can see on the screen there, that's going to be the remaining schedule. We were two matches down. We're going to head into the upper bracket, round of 64. So these are players that are currently just 1-0 in the tournament so far. So winner's bracket, of course, in a double elimination tournament is the place to be.
Mm-hmm.
It's the difference between having to win 5 matches to be in the top 8 and having to win 12 matches to be in the top 8 if you fall down to the lower bracket.
Yeah, and actually all the games that we're going to be streaming today are actually the upper bracket games. Mm-hmm. And so you're not going to see any lower bracket games. So we just wish them good luck down there and on the long road.
Godspeed, my friends, especially Pimping Ho.
So the bans are up, and we could see that Johnson banned the warrior, Eason's warrior, and that was a fatigue control. So we're not going to see that. And then Eason banned the shaman.
Yeah, I'm pretty sure that was just an aggro shaman. I didn't get a chance to look at it right before because the link wasn't loading for me. But Eason, you can see Eason on the screen. Eason's got some weird decks. We talked about, you said he has Fatigue Warrior. It's basically Fatigue. I mean, it runs all removal, basically all removal spells, and then Elise. And so its goal is to basically just grind you out of the game and then have legendaries to back it up with the removal spells that they didn't use.
Did it run Malkazar in there?
No, it ran, but Elise is sort of like the same thing, I guess.
Right.
You're still getting random legendaries, at least somehow. And it runs Ironforge Portals, and it basically tops out at Baron Geddon and Gore Howl. Like, those are the last two cards in the deck.
Nice. Well, we're not going to see that. But yeah, like you said, very interesting lineup. And his Warlock is actually a Dragon Reno, which I haven't seen, but you said you've seen a few of those.
I've seen a few, yeah. Dog recently played it at the One Nation of Gamers Grand Finals a week ago in Seattle.
Mm-hmm.
There's been a couple streamers that have been fooling around with it. It's basically Reno Lock, but instead of some of the like fringe cards that you normally put in Reno Lock, you run just Dragon Synergy cards.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, you already have a few dragons in there. You already have like Chilmaw is already run in many Nazoth Reno decks. And Twilight Drake is also run. So you basically just add a few more. You have Twilight Guardian and Azure Drake, and then Blackwing Corruptor.
Okay, it makes sense that they could like form a Dragon Reno lock. Is it really? Is it successful though?
It's about as successful as you'd expect a Dragon Reno Nazoth Warlock to be. which, I don't know, it's hit or miss. Reno Warlock in general is hit or miss. It relies on having a very certain meta, I feel like, to actually be successful. And I don't think this is the meta where it would be successful.
Right.
A lot of players brought Temple Mage, which I feel like Temple Mage, as long as they get a decent start, just rolls right over Reno. Aggro Shaman rolls right over Reno. Dragon Warrior can, but that's one of the better matchups for Reno. So I think that's what Eason was hoping for.
Right. Going back to the Reno, like the Reno lock, you don't see a lot of them. And like Tice was actually really upset that, like, because that was his favorite deck, and it's now out of, like, he says it's really bad now.
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah, this is going to be game one. Eason with his Freeze Mage against Johnson with his Dragon Warrior. So, I feel like the Dragon Warrior does have a chance against a Freeze Mage, but there are times where the Freeze Mage could actually take this.
Yeah, it depends how much early aggression you can muster. Dragon Warrior doesn't really have the sort of backup plan that a lot of warriors do against Freeze Mage, where you just armor up, because they just don't have any extra effects that give them armor.
Right.
Like, even the old Tempo Warrior would run Armorsmith a lot of times. So they could, if they wanted to, save up and make for a big Armorsmith like Ravaging Ghoul play. But nowadays, Dragon Warriors just don't. So they have to pressure. Fairy Dragon's really good at doing that, though, because Freeze Mage just doesn't, Freeze Mage just doesn't have a way to deal with Fairy Dragon.
Right, and Dragon Warrior can't really, like, armor up every turn. They're more like playing on curve.
They can armor up every turn.
Yeah, they can.
Just not very good. And I don't know.
The Finley, do you really want to lose your armor?
I think so, because you, like you said, you don't really want to armor up every turn, and armor up is just really bad. If you're not getting a lot of armor, then getting any armor is usually worse than developing a minion or drawing a card if you get life tap, or dealing 2 damage if you get steady shot, or even dealing 1 damage if you get fire blast can be better. So,
right. I feel like the mage hero power does well with the dragon warrior, especially because you can ping your Grom. But then there's Ichor for that too, and it's also just good for just execute.
Yep. It's also good for just making good trades. Not so much in this matchup.
Right.
Doesn't play the Finley on turn one.
Wow. Interesting.
I don't know if that's good.
Yeah, you need to start the damage already.
He really wants to armor up. I feel like pressure is the way you win this matchup. I don't feel like armor up's the way you win this matchup.
I feel like Ethan is just going to pass this turn too. I mean, there's no threats on the board right now. Save the coin.
Yeah. That... I think he's just trying to make Johnson think he has Doomsayer.
Oh, that's right. That's a good strategy.
Because one of the only ways that they can deal with Fairy Dragon early on is by just preemptively delaying it for a turn or two by playing Doomsayer and then just ignoring it for the rest of the game or hoping you draw Blizzard in time. So he's going to feign, and I don't know. I don't think Johnson should read too much into that.
Sometimes people do, though. It's like little mind games here and there.
All right, if he armors up, I'm just quitting Hearthstone right now.
No, he's not going to do that. We're going to see the Fairy Dragon. And may just have a hard time dealing with this. He's going to just take the 3 damage and deal with it later. Oh, yep, the loot order.
That is the only way. And if he didn't have Ravage Ghoul and would have had Ping as an option from Sir Finley, then
that's
he would be punished, but he won't be. Loot Hoarder is one of the only ways you can really challenge the Fairy Dragon.
I agree, yeah.
That and Blizzard.
So we're just going to see the Ravaging Ghoul here, most likely. Or, I mean, he could play the Monkey. That's another choice.
Could play the Monkey. Could also just Finley and try and get a 1 damage hero power. I mean, there's 3 of them.
That's
but
true.
Some of them aren't. Shapeshift isn't as good. And Dagger Up isn't that good because later in the game, a lot of times you have an opportunity to use the hero power again. And I feel like Steady Shot would be better. So Ravaging Ghoul just seems like the best.
Clear the board, drop a minion.
Maybe. Depends how Freddy is. The only real executes targets you have in this deck are Doomsayers, Emperor Thorsen, and Alexstrasza. So maybe he wants a activator for the execute, but none of those things will come down like this early in the game.
Right.
And I feel like Ravaging Ghoul allows you to apply the most pressure because you don't have to worry about Fierce Monkey forcibly getting traded into. You could protect your minions later on in the game by playing Fierce Monkey later in the game.
Right. I mean, if he dropped the Finley on turn one, then he would have had possibly the hero power. But yeah, the ghoul seems really great there.
When is he going to use Finley in this game? Who knows? Maybe never. How many times has he armored up this game? 0. How much damage has he missed by not playing Finley on turn one? 3.
He actually doesn't have the dragon synergy. Oh. So, we could just play the Korkron.
Korkron's pretty good. Applies pressure.
Definitely.
Maybe this could be a turn where he plays Fierce Monkey and Finley?
That's also a possibility. The Korkron is just really good pressure, though. And we can see that Eason doesn't have the Frost Nova to tie out to with his Doomsayer. Cone of Cold. Do you normally see that in Freeze Mage?
Freeze Mage lists are usually pretty tight nowadays, and even Flamestrike is sort of a fringe card in Freeze Mage nowadays. Mm-hmm. Laughing is sort of the go-to Freeze Mage connoisseur.
Yeah.
And if he's not running a Flamestrike, nobody's running a Flamestrike. Whatever he's doing is like is the gospel. You sort of have to follow it.
Yeah, he is the Freeze Mage god. I mean, he runs... I saw him playing around with Reno one time, and then he likes the mirror images.
Mm-hmm. Yep. One mirror image is pretty good. A lot of times one mirror image can block 10 damage. I mean, mirror image can sometimes be just as good as Ice Barrier. Mm-hmm. And Reno is good in control metas because you're going to get to the late game anyway where you're going to expend all your cards. And Frozen is also a player that, when he does play Freeze Mage, really likes to play Reno. Likes to play Reno and Malagos, which is super interesting.
Some people in their ways, I guess.
Yeah,
who knows? Just comfortable with certain decks.
Yeah.
So we might see the Finley here.
I don't know. I feel like if he hasn't played it yet, he just doesn't want to play it. He just wants to keep that armor up. But again, how many times has he armored up this game? And now how much damage has he missed by not playing Finley on turn one?
Right.
It's not even about the hero power in that case. It's about, well, he had a chance to get four extra damage in right now. Like, he had a chance to basically turn that Finley into a Corcoran Elite and give up his armor up. Potentially more if it could attack in here.
It's probably just the pressure, right? We're being, like, on stream.
But, I mean, maybe he thinks it's just better to hold on to it and keep armor up.
That's true.
It's really hard to say. Fire Dragon's a great card. But I feel like this Finley could be getting in a lot more damage. And if he plays it now, then, I mean, his not playing it on turn one was like a flat-out mistake.
Goes for the steady shot, which is... He's going to just smork it down.
I think it's the best one.
Yeah.
I mean, you have to apply consistent pressure to Freeze Mages in order to take him down.
If Eason Cones of Cold here, he could take out... The Fairy Dragon?
Finally,
right? Or he could coin the Blizzard. That's an option. Or just Arcane Intellect here.
Kind of like the Cone of Cold. I think the coin is really important, especially on a turn where you don't actually have to Blizzard.
Right. And Blizzard, it makes the next turn for Blizzard even better.
Yeah. Yeah, true. Makes next turn for Blizzard better. You don't have to really do anything this turn, and that coin might be useful for later on when there is a play that you have to make to survive. So his question here is whether or not he coins out Loot Hoarder, but again, you don't have to coin out Loot Hoarder.
Coin out Loot Hoarder? Coin out Ping?
Yeah. I guess it can test something on the board a little bit, but... Well, Grom is... I mean, Blood Dagger is pretty good because it activates Grom.
Yeah, I think for this turn, though, for Johnson, I think it's just going to be the Guardian and Hero Power. You don't get the buff, the 3-6, but you need to play something.
Sometimes the 2-6 just gets it done. Don't really need taunts against Freeze Mage, so... Forgo the hero power.
Right. And you just have to put, like, as a dragon warrior, you just have to put down whatever you have in your hand.
And he's a hero power every turn.
Yeah, get that so damage in. What do you think about new cards for the dragon warrior, like the curator? And
curator's really good.
Right.
It's not only good because of the fact that it has taunt. It's good because, one, Dragon Warriors don't really have 7 drops that they like to play. A lot of times on 7, they either play a 6 drop. Yeah, it sort of replaced Malkorok. Malkorok was very inconsistent. And the body wasn't very good for what Dragon Warrior wanted to do at that stage of the game. And that was sort of like reload and solidify their place on the board. Creator also gets some of the bad minions out of your deck. So if you haven't drawn on the family yet, it gets that out. It draws the Fierce Monkeys out. And a dragon out, which gets you closer to your big drops, and makes it more likely that you have an 8 drop to follow up on turn 8 after the curator. So curator sort of fit Dragon Warrior perfectly, and I'm surprised people didn't realize it sooner, because it took about like 2 weeks before people were like, wow.
As soon as I saw it, I was like, I'm going to try this. It looks great. You got like beasts, you got a Murloc, you got dragons. Seems to fit.
Yeah, I tried to make a weird combo deck with Arcane Giants.
With Dragon?
With Dragon, yeah. Mm. You get the Curator, you get Alexstrasza, Jeweled Scarab, and Cold Light Oracle.
There's your beast, the Scarab.
Yeah, because it's just 100% combo potential. If you haven't drawn your charge yet, Jeweled Scarab allows you to have an additional chance to pick up charge. So you play Arcane Giants and a bunch of removal spells, and if you haven't drawn your other combo pieces, you use the Cold Light Aura to get there. So Curator just like gets you close to everything. It also guarantees you get Alexstrasza. So you have two chances to draw Alexstrasza. You either draw Alexstrasza or the Curator, and so your combo becomes really consistent. So as long as you have enough removal to get through the early game, you always win. But that's the tough part. That's where they get you. Getting through that early game is actually a lot tougher than it seems with a Jeweled Scarab and a Cold Light Oracle in your deck.
Right. Is that what you've been climbing with?
No. That's what I've been falling with.
Yeah, with everyone just playing Dragon Warrior, it's going to be a bit tough, huh? Mm-hmm.
So things happened.
Definitely. We might... You could either like just get rid of this board and yeah, put down the Doomsayer, so it just like saves him a little bit of life.
Yeah.
Sets up the ice block.
Yes.
Oh, and speak of the devil, it's the Curator. But wait, does he want to kill this Doomsayer? Is he really just going to? Okay, well, he has room to execute.
Mm-hmm. And again, there's not really many execute targets in this deck, so you can afford to use them pretty liberally in the early game. Well, I guess it's not early game anymore, but you can afford to use them pretty liberally on Doomsayers to try and protect your board. He doesn't even have to use Blood to Ichor here as well to proc the execute, so it's going to be pretty good.
Mm. Yeah, I like that. Draw more cards. Save the Ichor for the Grom. The menagerie is
for guests only. Eason nods his head like, yep. He had it.
Expected. I mean, most Dragon Warriors run this card now.
Yeah, Chalky gave me a quote at the tournament that I cast with him playing last week, and he said, if you don't have the Curator in your Dragon Warrior deck, you're dumb. It's a verbatim, exact quote.
I like the trade here with the Thalnos. You don't want to leave the spell damage up.
It's a lot of gas Eason's picking up, though.
Yeah, but still no Alexstrasza. I hope you
like my invention. Yeah, he's got the burn, though. There's Acolyte of Pain.
At this point, he just has to stall before his opponent pops his block.
Yeah.
Grom Ichor is a possibility here, but it's not going to pop the block just yet. Or is he going to save it? Still no dragon synergy.
He hasn't tested for Ice Barrier yet, so he doesn't actually know.
True.
If it's Ice Barrier or Ice Block. I feel like Grom plus Blood Decker is good if you know that it's Ice Block. Because then it puts them down to 4, and you can just hear power down there. You never have to check for Ice Barrier after that. Or you never have to attack into an Ice Barrier after that. But since he doesn't know that if it's Ice Barrier, all of a sudden, if he Grom Blood Deckers into an Ice Barrier, then he's effectively only dealing 2 damage, and he's a lot more vulnerable if Eason did have a way to sort of clear the board over the course of a couple turns. So, oh, sorry, 5. He's going to put him at 5. He's rewarded for this play, because last turn, right, he attacked into the Doomsayer with his 1-1 and traded into the Blood Mage, so he never tested whether or not to see if it was Ice Barrier.
Right.
So a little bit of a risky play, but I think it's, at this point, he sort of needs to.
Eason can actually now stall for another turn before the ice block gets popped.
Yeah. But he also needs to make sure that he's also attempting to set up for a lethal opportunity.
Yeah, and he doesn't have Alexstrasza yet or another ice block. So
unless he draws another ice block here, he has to start thinking, I will need to kill my opponent without ice block.
Right.
So I have to start... like putting more Roaring Torches in my deck by just like using Forgotten Torch at face. And it looks like he's just going to try and buy as much time as possible and not use the burn spells yet. But this block isn't going to last very long, and that's going to be a block pop.
Yep. So yeah, Eason looks like he's in trouble right now.
Mm-hmm.
It's actually Is there any way he can come back from this? I don't think so.
No. There's not.
Yeah.
No Doomsayers left, so he's pretty much never going to clear this board unless he does, like, right now he flame strikes and trades in his whole board and pings or frostballs or something, and then he dies. So.
Yeah. I mean, the only thing that saves him for one extra turn is drawing into your ice block. But, I mean, since Johnson has the hunter hero power, it's just... he's doomed.
A lot of burn. A lot of burn.
Yeah. Just unfortunately, he didn't get the right cards.
Yeah. So Johnson's going to take game one, Dragon Warrior versus Freeze Mage, and, I don't know, decent win for him.
Right. So what do you think they're going to be playing next match?
Don't know. I think I honestly am in the core of the best strategy in Conquest is just a random. Just because, like, you never want to have a pattern, because then your opponent can mathematically determine what's the best deck to queue against you if you have a pattern.
Right.
So... and you have to win with all three decks anyway, so
yeah,
if you random, it's you have the best chance of winning because you don't have a pattern that's able to be recognized. I know there's some people out there that think that talk about the pick order a lot, but I hate talking about Conquest pick order.
Some people spend a really long time thinking about it too, though.
So I don't know.
So what is Eason's rogue?
It's really weird. So he runs double mana addict. Mana Addict is a card that probably most people haven't seen in a long time. It's the two mana 1/3 that every time you cast a spell on a turn, it gains two mana for that turn. Two attack for that turn. Yeah. So it's sort of like a questing adventure,
right?
Except you're not banking on your questing adventures attacking in multiple turns. You're basically using them to sort of OTK. You're getting all the value out of them in a single turn. So you conceal your mana addicts and then basically go off in a single turn, because it's actually more beneficial to do that than it would be to get a questing adventure that would only live for one turn anyway. Because a questing adventure only gains one attack per card, whereas a mana addict would gain two attack per card, given that it's a spell. So it was running old school Miracle Rogues back in the day. I remember Wreckful was when he used to be like an actual competitive player. You know, no shots fired at Wreckful. He doesn't spend enough time on it anymore.
I heard he missed Lethal.
I'm sure everybody's missed Lethal.
Yeah,
at some point.
It's just they give him like so much. They gave him a hard time because it was on like a stream.
Yeah.
It's the worst place to actually miss Lethal.
Yeah. But he was one of the first to sort of play around with a mana addict miracle style rogue. And so it's really cool to see that someone's trying to bring it back. Now that Questing Adventure Rogue is back, which was a thing back in the day.
It was back in the day also?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
A lot of times players will play Mana Addict and Questing Adventure because they didn't have tools at their disposal like they do nowadays. The rogues lists aren't as tight. They didn't have a Tomb Pillager. They didn't have Shadow Strike. So they'd run like really weird lists to try and, you know, make up for the fact. Back then, Gathering Auctioneer was also 5 mana, so... it was even stronger, it felt like. But it is a really weird rogue. We're not going to see it this time, though. It's going to be Mage versus Mage. Very different list, though. Freeze Mage for Eason and Tempo Mage for Johnson.
Right. How do these mages differ, though? Do you know any specific cards?
Well, you're talking about Johnson's from a normal Tempo Mage?
Oh, sorry. I thought you... I got confused for a second. I thought you said Tempo Mage versus Tempo Mage, but
no. Yes,
we know Eason has the Freeze Mage.
Well, Johnson's list does differ from normal Tempo Mages. He runs Babbling Book as well as double Babbling Book and double Cabalist Tome.
Oh, okay.
So it's a very
greedy.
Yeah, it's sort of a greedier, more control heavy list. He also has a little bit more top end. I think he runs Rag and one Firelands Portal, one Flame Strike.
Hey, Rag's great against Freeze Mage.
Yeah, I think Tempo Mage is great against Freeze Mage, period. As long as you have the right mindset going in. If you hold on to your Flamewaker for a really long time and go off on one single turn, Tempo Mage has more damage from hand than almost any other archetype or deck. So usually damage from hand is what beats Freeze Mage.
Yeah, and like Freeze Mage don't really put out a lot of minions, so all that damage is mainly going phase.
Yep.
So what did you think of the total damage is in a tempo mage? Did you ever count it all up?
It's a lot.
Like 30 and above?
Oh, it's well above 30. I mean, if every single one of your damage spells that can go phase goes phase.
Right.
I mean, 6 from Arcane Missiles, 6 from Frostbolt. Forgotten Torch is 18. Mm-hmm. So right there, that's already 30. Fireballs, double fireball, that makes it 42.
That's a lot of. And then the Firelands Portal.
Firelands Portal, if you run 2, then that's 52.
Yeah. Then he's got the Rag to top it off. And Yogg, of course. Yeah. And whatever Tome gives him.
Yep. So 52, if all spells go face in a standard Temple Mage list, would be exactly how much spells they have that could go face. I mean, yeah, you could take out Arcane Missiles if you want just spells that can just specifically target face, but that's only taking away 6, that's still 46. So
a lot of damage. So yeah, he's going to put out the Sorcerer's Apprentice. And actually, next turn, he could even draw for more cards or just play the Flame Waker.
Yeah, I like drawing better in this matchup. Playing Flame Waker is just asking to get Frostbolt pinged, and one of the best cards that you can have in this matchup. Even if you have 2, I think holding on to it is better. Because mm-hmm. he's not going to really develop anything on 4. He might develop a secret.
That's true. Like, I do notice that the tempo mages sometimes just hold on to their goodies sometimes and just like play them when they know they can deal a lot of damage.
Like Johnson might feel like, well, I have 2 Flame Wakers. Might as well drop one now because it's going to be hard. But I think the might as well scenario is much better with Arcane Intellect because then it gives you much more options to work with in the future. I think coin should most likely be held onto for Rag since Rag is also win condition. And
yeah, so he's going to do just that and see what he picks up. That's a lot of spells.
Arcane Missiles in this matchup is effectively 1 mana for 5 damage. Because there's never any minions on the board, so Flame Waker Arcane Missiles just deals 5.
It's just a slow start. Just both of them drawing.
Yeah.
So now, actually, he could coin out the Azurdrake. Would you do that?
I'd probably save coin for Rag. I think maybe this turn just Flame Waker Arcane Missiles. Just deal the 5 while you can.
Yeah, that's another option.
And then next turn, if he doesn't deal with Flame Waker, you just can Azure Drake, or you probably can't Cabals to him because you won't have enough cards. And that's one thing that he has to note is that he's got to really keep track of his card count because he's got a lot of cards that just can't be used in this matchup. Yogg, usually you don't want to use Yogg.
Yeah, I do like the... Going to go with the coin Azure Drake. And if he went with that other line of play with the... Flame Waker and Arcane Missiles, and then save the coin. Like the coin would have been used later with the Flame Waker.
Yeah. Trying to think through his next play, I guess.
Yeah. Gotta like take advantage of all that time.
Yeah.
Sometimes I feel like the rope time is not long enough.
Yeah, right? But I feel like a lot of players overthink.
Really? Yeah.
When they start taking a little bit too long. Or they feel like they, in a tournament setting, they rope because they feel like they should.
But I rope all the time.
But for players that play a lot of Hearthstone, sometimes you just gotta trust yourself. You gotta trust your instincts. Like, there's a reason why your brain's telling you to do something.
Mm-hmm.
And you have to go through all your options, but...
Yeah, when you start overthinking, I think that's when you usually mess up.
Yeah. And Babbling like Book, Flame Waker, Arcane Missiles.
Yeah, Drake's definitely going face.
Ooh, Counterspell. That could be really good.
Yeah, that could stop a Blizzard, a Frost Nova. Any sort. I mean, the Freeze Mage has a ton of good spells that are all like really important. Mm-hmm. So just stopping any one of them would be great. So yeah, do you think this is a turn for Flame Waker and Arcane Missiles now?
It's got to be.
Or he's thinking about putting up the counterspell with the Arcane Missiles. okay.
This is so slow. I don't know.
It's going to be a long game.
I don't know. You don't want to give Temple, or you don't want to give Freeze Mage time. Like, yeah, Johnson's probably thinking, oh, I got all the time in the world. Look at my hand. Such a good hand. Look at all these cool spells that I have. But Freeze Mage, if you give them enough time, they'll just kill you.
I guess Johnson doesn't know that Eason doesn't have a Doomsayer. I guess he's just... But, I mean, he has two Flame Wakers, you know? So even if he,
yeah,
even if he did have a Frost Nova Doomsayer, he could just, like, put out another one and just burst it with all the spells.
Or just fireball it.
Yeah.
I mean, either way, it would kill it. Like, the two plays that you're thinking about him making on turn six would be Double Secret, Arcane Intellect Secret, or Blizzard. And Blizzard doesn't deal with the board because the spell damage and the Flamewaker missiles are the important things in this matchup. Also, going into six, you don't want him to play Emperor Thor's hand, so you want to try and make as big a board as possible to make it so that he has to play off of what he'd like his curve to be.
Yeah.
So, I don't know. I feel like that ping was very slow.
And this is great for Eason because he wanted to play the Thorison on turn six. And, like, this is not really a threatening board, the one Drake and the babbling book. So now, and Johnson can't just, like, Flame Waker and Fireball here.
No, I think what Johnson was trying to do is just hold on to both Flame Wakers to try and go Flame Waker into a big spell chain. But that doesn't come really late in the game, and by the time... And now he sees a...
He actually could have played Obana Worm. And... No, I guess...
He wanted
a ping, yeah.
Wanted to get a ping instead. I don't know.
Just so much damage in the hand. Just want to... We're waiting to see it. We're waiting to see the fireworks.
Yeah. I mean, he could have invested into damage at this point.
Mm.
Like, even though pinging in the face is a point of damage now... Mana Worm could be, you know, multiple points of damage over the course of the game as opposed to that. So, and it also could force Eason to play differently if he knew that.
Now Mana there's Worm is on the no board. More. Now that he doesn't have a fireball to take out this Doomsayer,
there's no reliable way to do it.
Yeah, it's, it just seems like, oh, he can't even tome. It's just too much spells in his hand. He has to. Does he really have to? Okay, he's gonna set up a counterspell.
He's gonna counterspell, but if I guess it's the only play that he has. But if Eason Alex draws it on six and then made a Doomsayer play on seven, he's probably using Alex draws on eight. So
right,
he's not gonna cast any spells anyway. But I mean, I guess with if there's Doomsayer on the board that you're not confident that you can deal with, this is the only real play. And now if he Arcane Intellects, he's got a full hand, so he, unless he plays Mana Worm and just gives it up.
Yeah, he probably has to play... Oh, no. Yeah.
So it looks like if he plays Mana Worm, he's going to Arcane Intellect.
I think it's just a very awkward... I think he put himself in a very awkward turn.
I would have been okay with discarding mirror images to keep hold on to a Mana Worm. I don't know.
Right. And now Johnson is on a clock.
Let's see. Can he survive next turn? Because Eason... Wow, that was actually really bold by Eason.
Wait, does Eason have a ice block up? I can't see the if his mage has a secret up or not.
I think he does.
It's the ice block.
He wouldn't play... I don't think he would play Alexstrasza like that into a secret that he didn't know without ice block up. Right? Because if it was Mirror Entity, he'd effectively be at 12. I mean, I guess if it was Mirror Entity, he could Ice Lance it. But then he'd give up, like, potential lethal for the following turn. Because he'd be at 12, so that would mean that Fireball... I guess it wouldn't kill him, because he's already used a Fireball.
And, does this rag actually need to definitely take out?
Yeah.
Oh. Ouch.
All right.
Doesn't do it. And I feel like the Eason's just actually sitting very comfortable now. Well, Alexstrasza is there still on the board. There's no taunt stopping it.
He just wins.
Yeah, and this counterspell's not going to do that much. Oh. That's a big spell to block, but he's got a lot of burst, actually, so he's fine.
Plenty of damage, and Eason take the win. I feel like Johnson might have played that one a little bit too slow. Yeah. I understand where he's coming from, but you gotta, when you're playing Temple Mage against Freeze Mage, you gotta play fast and furious.
Right. Fast. Yeah, I mean, like, the more time you give the Freeze Mage, the more chance they have to win.
Yeah. I think if he had, you know, I liked the Arcane Intellect over Flamewaker on three, but you want to get those Flamewalkers out relatively early. You just want to cash in on them right away.
Right.
Like, Arcane Missiles didn't do anything. I'm pretty sure he still had Arcane Missiles in his hand at the end of the game. That could have been five damage. Could have forced Eason to play a little bit differently. If he had been able to coin out the Rag on seven, would have been a little bit differently. Even just not playing the Mana Worm, even though it would have been punished by Kona Cold, just forcing your opponent to have the answers to deal with that is what Temple Mage always does and what it should do. And played a little bit slow, yeah. And I guess he gets punished.
Didn't really feel like a Temple Mage in the end. And he just ended up having a ton of cards in his hand.
He drew more cards than Eason that game, I felt like.
Than the Freeze Mage.
Yeah.
Aw. Well, there's still a chance, and we are at 1-1 right now. Mm-hmm. So it can go any way, actually.
Yeah, and the remaining decks for Eason are the Dragon Reno Warlock, as well as the Mana Addict Miracle Rogue. Johnson has a Malygos Druid and the Temple Mage that we just saw, because we saw him take a win with the Dragon Warrior earlier on against the Freeze Mage. So still, Eason's got some bizarre decks, and this is what I talked about earlier in the intro. Southeast Asian players are very eager to take risks in their deck building, and they have very eccentric decks a lot of the times,
yeah.
Because they sort of take inspiration from a lot of different regions, as opposed to other regions like the Americas and Europe, which tend to take inspiration from very specific players. So all the decks become homogenized, and all the decks look very similar to each other.
I feel like they try to make something that's their own also, right?
Yeah, exactly, yeah. Like Pimpino with a Shaman. You don't really have players like that in Americas or Europe. The closest thing to it is like Zedalot in Europe, but he's not really... I mean, he's more of a streamer than a competitive player. He doesn't really actively seek to participate in like preliminaries and championship events, whereas Pimpinho does, and Pimpinho does it and then brings Totem Shaman and Beastrid to a major. So you don't have players like that in a lot of the other regions that are so loyal to deck lists and are so crazy with their deck building antics. So I'm not surprised to see Eason do this.
It's definitely exciting. It makes the game more fun and interesting, seeing new different things. And I mean, sometimes it actually works. We see that the Cycle Cthulhu, someone said it was actually an Asian player that made that, which Kalento eventually played on stream.
And Doomsayer.
Game number three. We got the Rogue, Eason's Rogue, versus the Tempo Mage.
Doomsayer in Rogue.
Yeah, that's interesting.
Yeah. A lot of times, Rogues just don't have turn two plays, unless they're coining out an SI7 agent to kill a two drop, if they're on the coin. Their turn two play is almost always dagger up.
Oh, yeah, that's true.
And so, in a lot of situations, you'd rather have Doomsayer because dagger's not going to be that impactful. It's interesting. Sometimes I prefer dagger up, but I understand why Eason chose to go with Doomsayer.
Yeah, I think it would really work well against aggro decks.
Mm-hmm.
Stopping Zoo and like aggro Shaman.
If you just dagger up against a Totem Golem, you're not going anywhere.
Yeah.
But if you Doomsayer against a Totem Golem, you're in good shape.
So Johnson with a great start, and I think from Eason we are going to see that Doomsayer soon.
We'll get killed though.
Yeah, he can actually kill it with the Arcane Blast.
We'll see if he wants to take the risk of going Flamewaker Arcane Blast, because then one of the missiles has to hit the Doomsayer. He loses his whole board. It's Flamewaker roulette.
I think Johnson's hand's really good against Eason's right now.
No turn to Doomsayer. That's so weird. I feel like that's the very specific reason why it's put in the deck.
Mm-hmm. I think I would have played it and just hoped for the best.
And Wild Pyromancer. What is this?
Yeah, it's very strange.
Oh, he's going to conceal the Doomsayer.
Oh,
my goodness. That's why he held on to it. But that feels like it's such a... Not a waste of conceal, but it feels like it's such a weird use of conceal when the deck's win condition is to conceal a mana addict.
But this this stops the Tempo Mage from doing anything this turn. So,
I mean, except for pushing a bunch of damage. And now he doesn't have conceal, so if he makes something big, then it's more likely to be able to be dealt with by Johnson. I mean, he does have the second conceal, so it's just a weird conclusion. It's a cute play. I like it.
Mm. But will that 17 life be enough against a Tempo Mage? I mean, like we said earlier, Tempo Mages have a ton of burst.
Oh, yeah.
I think he has to put down, a huge Fan Cleave soon.
Yeah, and I don't see a good one this turn.
Yeah, not.
He can coin prep Wild Pyro, Edwin Conceal.
I think he's going to do it.
Yeah.
This is good,
it's good sequencing for what he wanted to do.
Right. And we've seen the...
Wait, what? He concealed first? Because he didn't want to damage his Van Cleef? Or he wanted to be bigger?
Bigger. Because we've seen one mirror image already, so he's not worried about another one. It's actually really crazy. How is this Tempo Mage? How's Johnson gonna deal with this?
He's not going to.
He's gonna have to take 10 damage to the face. I think he has to just put out everything that he can right now. Mana Worm, Sorcerer's Apprentice, kill this Pyro before it kills his board.
It's not going to happen. That's sort of ingenious. The Doomsayer conceal play.
It's actually nuts.
I was running it through my head. I'll be like, what? Why would he not run? Why would he not Doomsayer on two when, you know, that's why he puts in the deck? But I guess the reason why he puts in the deck is because it's got a lot of uses with conceal. It's almost a guaranteed board clear. It's sort of like Frost Nova Doomsayer, except you're taking all the damage from the board on the backswing. But, I mean, if you have enough...
Check this out.
Yeah, it's full clear.
Actually, he can play Mana Addict. Right?
I think just clearing the board and hitting for 10 is going to be better. This guy's I don't think Mana Addict is like the win condition.
You're right,
I think just hitting for 10 three times is going to be the win.
I'm getting excited, sorry. He's just got to kill this Mana Worm with his face, with his dagger. Oh, this is crazy. He can't deal with this Van Cleef. Let's just it's what I said earlier. He needs to make this Van Cleef, and he did do it on that turn,
yeah.
Actually.
Turn 6, ping, pass.
What a crazy match, this Rogue.
Yeah. I mean, that has to be game.
This is going to be a highlight.
Yeah. I mean, that was actually just really sick.
Right, I know. The Doomsayer conceal. Oh, wow. Who would have... I didn't see it coming. You didn't see it coming.
I should have seen it coming.
You've been casting a really long
time. I should
have
seen it coming.
I guess nobody's done it.
I don't think I've ever seen somebody conceal a Doomsayer, or
right?
At least not in a long time. Then again, I've never seen someone run Mana Addicts in a long time.
So going back to that conversation we had earlier about Asians making strange decks.
Yeah, it's very true. So I don't know what his game plan here is, but Grim Patron is not really going to help him out. And that's going to be concede from Johnson. And Eason takes a 2-1 lead.
Oh, that was
the back
nuts.
Of some really good rogue play. But I guess that's more deck building than it is play, because he's probably made that play hundreds of times in practice for this deck. But,
so,
I mean, that also goes to show just the strength of Van Cleef when you have preps and... the coin, like being able to put out a 10-10 on turn 5 without really using too many resources is actually absurd.
I feel like the Edwin Van Cleef is also really great against Dragon Warrior. When they put out that big Edwin and you don't even have Execute, it's just done.
And Execute's not a card that they keep.
Yeah, definitely.
You know, Control Warriors are a lot more likely to have that, but people always talk about, well, Execute's the best hard removal in the game, but it's the only hard removal that Tempo Warriors and Dragon Warriors actually have, so they kind of rely on it in those situations. But Eason's last deck is the Dragon Reno Nazoth Warlock.
And I think we are going to see some cool stuff there, too, especially after seeing that rogue, like, concealed Doomsayer. I wonder what else he has up his sleeve. So the last deck, the last two decks, again, for Johnson is the still the Tempo Mage and the Mali Druid.
Yeah. Malygos Druid should perform pretty well against Reno Locks because they can, a lot of times, they can buy enough time to where they can OTK. But Reno Locks, if they have a good curve, like if they just have 2-drop, 3-drop, 4-drop, 5-drop, 6-drop, 7-drop, then they could just beat about any, just about any deck except for like a perfectly curved Aggro Shaman or Dragon Warrior. So, I don't know. Reno Lock just struggles because of its inconsistency.
I've had a few matches with a Token Druid against, it was not Mali Druid, but a Token Druid against Reno Lock, and I feel like it's kind of tough. Like, I found it kind of hard because they do have like a lot of clears to deal with your tokens, and then there's Twisting Nether. But I'm not sure entirely what this Dragon Reno would be like. So
yeah, the Violet Teacher is sort of just like a secondary effect. A lot of times you just throw out your Violet Teacher just to say, here, like, deal with this. But then they have Malygos as a win condition. They have Arcane Giants as a win condition as well. But we're not going to see it yet. Or no, well, we're not going to see the Malygos Druid from Johnson yet, but Eason does have this deck as his only remaining one. He really likes Doomsayer. I'm pretty sure all of his decks have Doomsayer. All four of them, including his Fatigue Warrior, have Doomsayer.
MVP Doomsayer. Yeah. And Johnson back with his Tempo Mage. He's got to get that win.
He's 0-2 with the Tempo Mage right now. Not good.
It could be the deck that fails him.
Yeah.
But we'll see. We got Eason. Eason here has a lot of removal in his hand.
Yeah. So
I don't think he wanna. Do you wanna double Arcane Missiles here?
Eason is very confused, and this play is gonna get heavily punished.
Uh oh.
By Doomsayer. Johnson will have to draw exactly a damage spell.
Yeah, two Cabalist Tomes is not really what you want to have in your hand as a Tempo Mage.
I mean, maybe Eason feels a little bit uncomfortable here because of the fact that Johnson went all in with the Mana Worm. He's probably thinking, well, he's got a lot of burn, so he might even just coin Shadow Bolt to deal with this. He's so confused.
I mean, we can clearly see the answers, right? We know that Doomsayer is great here. But yeah, it's just, Eason's just, what is going on?
He's thinking, what would drive a man to double Arcane Missiles with a Mana Worm on board on turn two?
Right. And you could never guess that he has two tomes in his hand after that. Yeah. But you know what? He's going to stick to his game plan.
Which great job, Eason.
That's crazy.
Yeah.
I guess Johnson was thinking, you know what? I don't really have anything. I want this Mana Worm to do the most damage it can.
Yeah. This is how Johnson should have played the Freeze Mage game.
Right.
Because the decks sort of work in a similar way. If you give them time, they're just going to beat you.
Well, maybe when he watches the VOD and he's going to be listening to what you have to say.
Maybe. Or maybe he'll disagree with me because he made that play for a reason. But
Right. Just
like some inconsistencies in his play, especially the not playing Sir Finley on turn one, but then playing it on turn four when he had an extra mana.
Oh, look, Babbling Book gave him a Pyroblast.
I feel like that card's like 50% chance to give you a random mage card, 50% chance to give you Pyroblast.
Right? I've heard someone say that to me. That's why I was like, I had to mention it. I think it was Maru.
Oh, yeah. Me and Maru, we think alike.
Oh. I don't know. I just love the dragon synergy. I feel like dragon can work just in about any deck, because Blackwing Corruptor, Blackwing Technician. When Blackrock is out of the
let's rotate it out.
Yeah, it's gonna be kind of sad.
Yeah, Flamewaker's going as well.
Emperor Thorsen. There's probably gonna be no Freeze Mage anymore.
Yeah, it's a possibility. I mean, they might get some more tools, but I don't know. Freeze Mage is. A lot of people don't like Freeze Mage. I don't really like Freeze Mage either.
Kibler?
Kibler hates Freeze Mage.
I know. Why? I mean,
it's very non-interactive.
Yes, I agree with that. But I mean, it's just a different deck, and I'm all about like different stuff. But yeah, it's just, I guess some people find it boring because you don't actually physically like put stuff out in your deck.
I mean, you know exactly what Freeze Mage is going to do. Your opponent knows exactly what you're going to do. And sometimes they literally cannot do anything to stop it. And, you know, that's a deck archetype that a lot of people just don't like. I mean, Aeson's getting pretty low. I mean, he has to tap here because he knows that he has to find Reno. Because if Johnson played the double Arcane Missiles on two, his game plan is to be aggressive. So I'm pretty sure Johnson is just going to try and kill as early as he can. And, I mean, this Flame Waker, blow shots to face, it's probably where he actually wants them to go.
Wow, that's nice. And he's got the mirror image to top it off. You know what? If he was close to turn 10, Johnson would be feeling pretty good with the Pyroblast.
I mean, he might just kill him next turn with a Fireball. Mm-hmm. Bookworm value, though.
Saved for now.
All right. This is just when you Fireball Pink Face. And if he doesn't have Reno, you win the game.
Yeah, I like the Firelands portal here.
Oh, Firelands portal is better, yeah. Because you get the minion pressure as well.
Right. Oh my gosh.
Wow.
Oh my gosh.
Johnson just casually looks to the side. He's like,
oh my gosh.
Anybody see how good I am?
I think this is going to be it.
That's huge because now we can't even tap.
Yeah, he can't.
Well, he wouldn't have been able to tap for Reno anyway, but he could have tapped for.
Ouch.
Like Cult Apothecary to try and bring him out of range of anything. And that's just it. He's going to play Bog Creeper here to just try and taunt up and hope that Johnson literally has 0 points of burn.
Yeah, but you can see he's already shaking his head and he knows that, come on, he hasn't seen a Fireball yet.
Well, we ask what would drive a man to play Arcane Missiles on turn two with no burn in hand. But Johnson just had a lot of faith in those Cabalas Tome, and that faith paid off, and that means we're going to a game number five.
I know. This is actually my second time to go into game number five. I had one with Maro, and now with you.
I had a 3-0 early in the day with Neelio versus Pimpiho. And Neelio told me, I went down and talked to him a little bit after his match, and some of like the Mana Surge guys. And Neelio has actually never lost a match that I've casted. I've casted like 8 of his matches.
You're his good luck charm.
That's what he says.
Oh my gosh. Did you tell him you drafted him too?
No, I didn't tell him. I don't want to jinx any superstitions that he has because he said if they told him that they were going to stream his match and I wasn't casting, he'd refuse. So
That's really funny.
I hope nobody tries to force him to be on stream without me casting.
Aww.
But yeah, last match is going to be Johnson's Malygos Druid versus Aeson's Reno Dragon.
Right.
Warlock.
We haven't seen that Mali Druid yet.
No, I'm pretty sure it's Mali Ghost Druid. The bottom of the deck list for each of the players wouldn't load all the way. I saw like Moonfires.
Okay, if it's got Moonfires.
Don't think you would play no Mali Ghost with Moonfires, but you never know.
Right, and Frozen did make the Mali Druid really big.
Mm-hmm.
Winning all those matches with it.
Yeah. Frozen and Zixo. Zixo sort of made the non-Violet Teacher version popular, and Frozen sort of made the Violet Teacher version popular. I actually prefer the non-Teacher version.
Mm-hmm. What does it replace it with?
Well, it runs a Gadgetzan Auctioneer. Mm-hmm. It runs an extra 3-mana spell and an extra Mire Keeper. So a lot of times the Violet Teacher version runs like a single copy of Feral Rage and No Mulch. Whereas the non-Violet Teacher version runs 2 Feral Rages, or 1 Feral Rage, 1 Mulch, and it runs double Mire Keeper instead of 1 Mire Keeper, and it gathers in Auctioneer.
Yeah, I remember Frozen's list had only 1 Mire Keeper.
Yeah. So with no Violet Teacher, you need to have more consistent ramp, so you want Mire Keeper more often, because on 4, instead of just playing a Violet Teacher, you want to ramp to get to the gathers in Auctioneer turn much quicker, so... Mm-hmm. All right, well, that's a pretty good opening hand for Johnson in a slow matchup.
Yeah, I like the... I mean, it's how is Aeson even going to deal with the Fandral? What card does a...
Shadowbolt Mortal Coil.
Yeah.
It's the only way.
It's going to be tough for Aeson then.
Well, I don't know if Johnson's going to keep Fandral. If this is Malygos, you want to ramp and draw early.
Get those Innervates.
Yeah, but I feel like against Reno Lock, Fandral's just too good of a keep. I might have even three kept there. Because what are you hoping to draw into in this matchup? Like, you're hoping to draw into ramp, but with Fandral being played on turn three, Wrath actually becomes really good because all of a sudden you answer the threat that they're going to try and play to contest the Fandral, and you also draw a card. So, I don't know. Might have liked to see a three keep there. But gets a Feral Rage instead.
You said, and we know that this is a sort of dragon Reno, but we have some interesting cards here. We have, oh, look, Nazoth. We have a Nazoth, Acidic Swamp Ooze. And the, I guess the Panda Brewmaster is just for the Reno.
For Reno, also Nazoth in longer control matchups.
Oh, right. So we could we'll see the Fandral here. Or he could just... I don't know if you Feral Rage this. It's not a good target to Feral Rage.
There's not that many great targets to Feral Rage, though. I think what Johnson was hoping was that he didn't have a 2-drop, that he was going to tap on 2. And that's why he kept the Fandral in the first place. So this might make him change his plan, because all of a sudden there are so many cards that answer this now. You know, just Shadow Bolt, Demon Wrath. Oh, there's more than that. I'm missing cards. Even like Dark Peddler into Abusive Sergeant, or Dark Peddler into like anything. But I guess there's about 3 or 4 cards that counter it, so he's just hoping that he doesn't have the second one.
Yeah.
And Eason might be forced to attack in Demon Wrath here, even though it's really inefficient. Leaving Fandral up for a full turn is too risky.
I agree. He has to get rid of it with the Demon Wrath. And now Johnson's kind of stuck here with a bunch of spells, no minions. Well, so he's going to have to make a minion with the Power of the Wild.
There's that Moonfire.
Yeah,
making an appearance.
It's kind of a slow turn. Not really the best turn for Johnson there. Coin? Or okay. Contests against the Panther. It's just more spells. Oh, no.
Yeah.
Oh.
That hand's pretty rough.
Yeah, he's actually thinking about swiping face, and he's just hero powering down this panda.
Yeah, I like that. It applies pressure. Your hand's really not telling you anything else. If you draw Malygos, you're in a pretty good spot because you have a bunch of damage from hand.
I guess he didn't play the Imp Gang boss because of the swipe.
It's possible. Maybe he just felt like he needed a whole nother coin to get a 6-drop out this turn. Like, being able to coin out Emperor Thorsan is a pretty big deal.
Yeah, that's great. Yeah, we're going to see a lot of Eason's minions come out pretty soon. Johnson has a lot of spells to deal with this Emperor Thorsan, and he's probably most likely going to play the Yogg when the time comes.
This is a Yogg game.
He could swipe and Moonfire and Hero Power, and then just innervate the Yogg next turn?
Yeah, he could try and go all in with spells.
Right.
He could also just Feral Rage Hero Power down.
Oh my goodness. Sorry, we're just like hearing a bunch of random sounds.
I hope everybody else is hearing that too.
Yeah.
All right, well, he decides to take a middle ground here with the Feral Rage. He could still innervate out Yogg next turn, and he could Moonfire innervate Yogg if he really wanted to go for it. But I think Johnson doesn't want to play the Yogg yet because it could punish him pretty heavily. It's not like enough spells from Yogg to where it would be super impactful. A Yogg in that situation would effectively just be to draw cards.
Yeah. You know what's really good against Yogg? Sylvanas.
Yes. Of course, if you don't know the interaction, people at home, if any of Yogg spells kills the Sylvanas in real time, your opponent will steal the Yogg and the rest of the spells will be cast for him.
I know. It's been it happened to me. It feels so bad.
Yeah. I mean, sometimes it doesn't matter because there are some spells that are like side neutral.
Doom.
Any targetable spell, Doom, Twisting Nether. Like, whether or not Lightning Bolt is cast from your Yogg or his Yogg is completely irrelevant.
Yeah, that's true. Could hit your face, my face.
Yeah. Yogg spell damage also benefits from Malygos. There are not many minions that Yogg's spells will trigger. Like, Yogg spells, for instance, don't trigger Flamewaker missiles. All right.
I'm going to see the Mali.
Look at Yuzit's face. He's like, oh, well then.
Is this really happening right now?
That's a Malygos. And
okay.
He didn't get the attack off. I don't think the attack was right there anyway. I mean, I think Eason's plan here is just to play Sylvanas.
Yeah, I think he knows that. Okay, he's played Malygos because Yogg is coming up. Possible Yogg.
Always like possible 9 damage swipes.
Right.
Possible 7 damage living roots. Possible 10 damage star fires if he gets it from Raven Idol.
It's actually kind of scary because
I have no time.
Yeah. The Sylvanas is like the only thing he could do.
Yeah.
He doesn't even want to tap anymore.
So if Johnson draws any damage spells, nope. That's not it. But I think you gotta go for it. Just swipe base and then hit face.
Swipe an arcane giant.
Yeah, I mean, I guess. Force him to have both.
Oh no, but this means, the Sylvanas is gonna steal the Mali. Isn't it? Because it can trade into the Mali.
Oh yeah, that's right. The collateral damage would kill off the Malygos.
Like, he's like, I don't really want to swipe.
Eason's like, what? I mean, I think that's correct because his plan is to just play Yogg next turn. So he's hoping that Yogg is just going to kill the Malygos. Work in the game. I mean, he's going to be at 7. So he has to... Oh, 8, sorry. He's going to kill off the 1. I don't know if that... What does killing off the 1-1 accomplish? Who knows?
You can't Hellfire, that's for sure.
Oh, that is for...
Oh.
That is for very sure.
It's just a weird thing that's going on right now. Like, does he even want to tap? He wants Reno, but it's like, are you going to get it? Probably not.
I mean, I think this is going to be his last tap. I think he can tap this turn because he can reasonably play around everything but, like, a crazy Yogg. So this, I'm pretty sure this, like, has to be a tap. Because he's got to get close to that Reno. Because there's no spells that are going to kill him from 6. He'd have to have like a combination of spells to kill him from 6. So he can play around every like single card from 6. And I think this might be the last turn that he's going to be able to fit in a tap. And he finds Azurdrake, which is great because it's just more cycle to try and get through minions. We'll see what he picks up. Twilight Guardian. It's not a Reno. And this has got to be a Yogg.
So exciting.
I think he ended the game because his cards are green. He said, can't even look.
Oh, no.
Yeah, I still think he just ended the game, though.
Yeah, I don't know. Oh.
There's the swipe. Got him.
Wow. Oh, my gosh. That
Johnson
was
pumped.
Oh,
man.
My gosh. I can't even deal right now.
If you ever win a 5-game set off the back of a YOLO swipe to the face to let your opponent steal your Malygos to set up for what's basically his only chance to win that game, and that's a Yogg-Saron on 10. Wasn't even that many spells.
Right.
Probably like 8 spells cast that game. And to have it end the game in that fashion, pretty crazy. And Eason... You know, gotta commend him for bringing some crazy decks, but you gotta commend Johnson for some ballsy play.
Yeah, we got the replays coming up, so we're gonna see that crazy stuff happen again.
Yeah, not quite sure, but which one it is, because there were some pretty crazy highlights in that game.
Definitely
in
the Yogg. Probably the Edwin also is another
Edwin,
good one.
Even just the double arcane missiles to face actually was a big deal. Because it's not a play that a lot of people will make. Having double Cabal's Tome in your hand, you're like, okay, I got to play the long game. Johnson's just like, nah. I'm just going to push a bunch of damage. And I think they're trying to tell us something.
Yeah.
In that they're trying to get rid of us.
Yeah.
But you can't get rid of us that easy.
Yeah, we're not going just yet. We're going to see the replays. We can't miss those replays.
Yeah. But Eason's going to have a tough road. Like I said, got to come in for his decks, but falling to the lower bracket in the second round of play in a 128-man field is pretty tough.
It is really tough. Especially, oh my gosh, imagine falling into the lower brackets after the first match.
Yeah. All right, well, here we go.
Oh, okay, so this is where the Rag is going to miss the Alexstrasza.
Yeah. Again, the secret that was up was Counterspell, so he effectively had to hit the Alexstrasza, or he 100% lost the next turn. We talked about the Simple Mage game, though. A little bit slowly played by Johnson.
Mm-hmm.
Hard to tell if that would have made an impact on the game, since Eason did roll Emperor Thorsand on 6 into Clear the Board on 7 into Alexstrasza on 8. That's a tough hand to beat, no matter what you're playing. But yeah, Rag missing, definitely a big indicator in that game. And the Doomsayer Conceal. Man.
This is like probably play of the game, right? Yeah. Play of the match. This is nuts.
Sort of like Frost Nova plus Doomsayer, except for, you take the damage from the minions. So at this stage, it was really cool play, but I was worried about, can he afford to take that much damage? But then the following turn, Eason made a 10-10 Van Cleef, using his resources incredibly well, playing the Wild Pyro, using the Conceal on nothing just to try and get a bigger Van Cleef, knowing that there was no way that Johnson would be able to deal with it without like Frostbolt plus a bunch of removal afterwards. A risky play, but paid off.
This is just too good. Sorry. Yeah, it's just a Grim Patron.
Yeah.
And finally, the Yogg.
Yeah.
Oh, not yet. Not yet.
Not yet. Not yet.
Not yet. You know what? I guess, the last match, the winner was the... Yogg has actually been doing some work.
Yeah.
All these Yogg decks are actually winning.
Yeah. Can't 100% rely on Yogg, though. I mean, I feel like these decks would be pretty good without Yogg anyway.
Oh, this is the one.
Yeah,
this is the one with the Doom Guard. I was actually about to say that in the last one, but it was actually the Grim Patron.
You could see how stressed Eason actually was. And, he got up to a lead in the series. You could see in this very match, it's the Reno Warlock that just let him down a little bit throughout the series, and we talked about its inconsistency throughout the match, and here we go. Johnson willingly giving up his Malygos to get the 9 damage swipe to the face. Having 100% faith that his Yogg would end the game.
Right. I guess he attacked the imp so that more damage would actually hit the face.
Huh. Yeah.
It worked out.
Yeah. Didn't get to see the Yogg, but that's okay.
But I really liked Eason's confused.
Yeah. That's okay. Johnson will move on. He'll be moving on to the round of 32 winner's bracket. So the round of 64 winner's bracket that was. Going through the whole upper bracket through the winners actually makes your path much easier to get to top 8. It also means you have that sort of one game leeway. So if you lose in the top 8, you go down to sort of the loser's lower semifinal right away. So it means much less games played over the course of the day, which makes it a much easier path. But it was a fun series.
Yes, and we are going to go on a quick break. But seriously, guys, don't go anywhere. We have more exciting games to come. Right, TJ?
Yes, right after this.